Hello again, this is Ryan with Better Tattooing. We're going to be doing another video for you today in an Are You Doing That Right section, and it's packing color. Are you doing that right? All right. Okay, now that that's over with, I brought out my tea today because it's freezing cold outside. We're having snowpocalypse, Snowmageddon, quarter inch of snow. And people are going to be quite displeased when they see what's happening. People on the West Coast don't know how to drive in the snow. That's all I can say. Unless you're in West Coast Canada, above Vancouver, rock and roll guys. That's the true Northwest. Alaska, hey, just, you know, Portland, California, Washington, a little bit crazy with the West Coast stuff. Anyways, we're not talking meteorology. We're talking about packing color. And I get asked this a lot by people. They say to me, like, how come I can do one color, but I can't do another? And so we usually what we do is we do something like, pen's all sideways there. We'll lay out two ink caps. And one ink cap we'll have, because everyone's like, I can pack black, fine, but I'm having a hard time with something like, you know, blue or green or yellow. And it's not fizzy. So this is like color number one, and this is color number two. And they're comparing these, and I think that there's like a utility in people's minds where they're sitting there thinking, okay, well, these are two different substances given the fact that I cannot do one as efficiently as the other. It would be like running a marathon in one type of shoes versus another, right? Or driving one car versus another and getting to some place faster or slower. So there's this weird equivocation that isn't being met, or weird comparison that is being created, where they're looking at these substances as something different. And instead of accepting the fact that maybe they're not doing something perfect, they start to blame the thing that they're working with. Now, realistically, when we look at both of these colors and we break them down, they end up with an ingredient list of pigment, water, alcohol, and we'll just bracket this, surfactants. Right? Now, if we think about this, the bulk of these products that we're gonna be using, especially if you're using common brands, isn't going to be the pigment that's in it. It's going to be the surfactants, water, and alcohol, the performance enhancing things that are going to change how this is at, right? And glycerin can be added into that, right? Might as well. So the pigment that's actually in it, even though it may be one of the first ingredients, by volume, it's not actually the most that's in there, right? The water and alcohol mix that we have, our carrier fluid is gonna be the number one thing. It's gonna make up the bulk of that product. And so the pigment is gonna be the thing that we may see that is different, right? Normally companies will create a carrier fluid, like just these huge vats of it, and they'll use it for some type of consistency of blend as they add it to pigments. Even if it's small batch stuff, the carrier fluid that they're using is not created small batch. So when they get into doing the mix and you know, bottling up thousands of bottles, the only thing that changes is the pigment, right? Now, if we take a look at the pigment specifically, we start seeing that, well, it's all basically just some like sandy feeling stuff texturally. So to me at least, and I think to like very experienced tattooers out there, which I may not be considering myself one, I'm just looking at it from the outside in, right, of course, as kind of like an engineer of this stuff, rather than, and I am a practitioner, but I mean, you know what I mean? Like, I'm not an artist, I'm like a tradesperson when I do this. Academic tradesperson. What I'm seeing is, if we remove the color value from this, and we don't think about what the color is, and we just look at the substances, regardless of what the outcome is, I would start asking questions like, what technique are you using that is different from, we'll say, A to B? If we do like the Pepsi blind challenge taste test thing, right? What are you doing different with these? What is going on? So like my approach to this is always going to be, what are you doing, rather than what is the pigment doing? Because if like the pigment is just what it is, it's a liquid. It's a suspension, and it just is what it is, right? People's skin can change, but the product that you're using, if it works fine on one person and it doesn't work as well on another, there may be some issues that are coming up to this, right? So we'll do our I don't know, whatever, breakdown on this stuff about how to fix it if you're doing this stuff, right? If you're doing this right and you're not doing it right, and you're wondering what the hell is going on, here's some fixes. Because like ink is ink. I don't know what to tell you. One second.
Remember to like, subscribe, and if you want to show support for the show, check out the video description for a link to our Buy Me a Coffee website thing. We appreciate any and all support that you've given us so far, and hopefully we'll continue to in the future.
All right, answers to your issues with packing color. I had to stop, my kids called me. Anyways. But I'm not retaking this. I don't write notes. I don't want to lose it. It worked well, so I'm just using it again. Anyways, packing color, you know, if you're not doing it, if you're finding that your results are just a little bit lacking, here's some things you can do to try to improve it, right? One is shake your pigments. Shake it up, right? TS that shit. More often than not, when I see people who are just into tattooing, they use visual representation of efficacy on everything, right? They're not thinking about things in a more complex state. So if we have a bottle of pigment, right, that is whatever color, X color, what they end up doing is they look at it and they say, cool, red, and then it automatically goes into an ink cap. So what happens is depending on the type of pigments that are in there, we can actually get a lot of settling. And this is why many surfactants or performance enhancing products are actually added to pigment, is to try and make it so that it doesn't separate as quick, right? Like if we have just a cup of water, right, and we have a cup of glycerin, and we pour, you know, this is glycerin, that's water. If we pour ink into each one, how fast is that ink gonna settle and move towards the bottom? And one product, like the water, right, it's gonna move very quickly. We're gonna see it, we're gonna disperse, it's just gonna settle or mix or whatever it's gonna do. But the glycerin is gonna take a long time for that to occur, if it even fully does. So this mix of whatever stuff, where we'll just get like some pockets of where things are gonna set, while everything in the water may settle down lower. Since this is delayed, many people, when they're looking at pigments and they have these like surfactants in them, they think that their stuff is already mixed, when realistically, depending on the actual weight of whatever products are in there, you can have layering appear, right? Where we may have a lot of the pigment that's naturally dispersed, but some of the other mixing stuff inside of it, like the white, has settled very hard at the bottom and caked up. That's why they put those little beads in them, right? They put those little ball bearings or glass beads. So when you shake it, the force is actually impacting that stuff at the bottom, forcing it to break up so it can get mixed back up with those pigments that are above it. And so when I see people initially having an issue with a color one day versus another, I'll ask them, like, how old is your ink? They're like, I just got it, you know, 2 weeks ago. Okay, well, probably when you first got it, it was a bit better mixed than what you had now. It's probably settled. If you just shake it, it'll be good. And I've done that in a couple videos. I've talked about that. Like when you go to use colors, you know, rip your gloves, and we're gonna deposit ink when we're needed, or when it's needed, based on the quantity of how much like white is in it, especially, as you go, rather than just dispensing everything out at the beginning and thinking that it's just beautiful. Because a lot of people nowadays are running their machines like 24/7 when they're actually going. So never turning them off, there's a greater risk of bottoming out when you hit the ink cap. While if you're using a foot switch, it used to be you could turn it off and you could deep dip into the actual cap and get it right down to the bottom, which would naturally break up some of that settling, and you would get a better mix when you went to actually go put it into the skin, which would lead to better results, right? So that's the first one. Shaking it up is the absolute first fix if I'm gonna do it. If you're doing something, it doesn't seem like it's working, go back, get a new ink cap, shake the hell out of that bottle of ink, maybe for about 2 minutes or so. I mean, like really 2 minutes, time it. And then dispense it and see if there's an improvement. If there's an improvement, boss, you just figured out something on your own, that's great. If it doesn't, then we go to number two, right? Number two with the packing color is, are you using different techniques? Right? Techniques. Oops.
geez, I can't spell today. I've only had a half a tea. Techniques. If you're using different techniques to try and do each one of these, just remember it's just ink. If you are able to line with black, but you can't fill with black, what are you doing differently? More often than not, I'll see people doing tight circles. Don't do tight circles. It's just not necessary. It chews up the skin, especially if you're moving really slow, and it's just a bane for a lot of these people who are out there, because your clients are going to end up with a tattoo that ages quickly, and it just looks nasty walking out the door. If your tattoos are leaving and they're pouring blood, you have done something wrong, okay? So, number two, different techniques. If you are using something different, just go back to what works. If you know you can pack a line, fill the whole thing with lines. In fact, that's one of the best ways to fill, and we've talked about this in another video, right there. All you're doing is just a modified whip fill and everything. Coming one way, pulling, right? Pulling from one side to make sure that you're keeping the ink up, especially if you're doing drop, and depending on which hand that you have, pulling the opposite, coming back the other way. It's the easiest way. 1 to 2/3 overlap, simple. If you don't know how to do that, and you're having troubles with all of this stuff, then I hate to say it, number three is you kind of suck. And I'm not trying to be harsh on people here, but like if you are doing this at home and you're trying to teach yourself, you're probably not doing it right. Hands across, right? I'm not saying that if you go to a shop, you're gonna have this mythological unicorn of a fucking apprenticeship and everything's gonna work out perfectly. No. But what you're gonna have is somebody who's sitting there that you can try to mimic off of to start feeling your way through. Like, tattooing is invention, especially when you first get into it, without people trying to explain to you how to do stuff. Like, I explain everything to a point of just, it makes people's eyes roll when we're getting into talking about tattooing, especially like first and second year tattooers. So I do that because I want them to know as much as possible, right? I want them to know everything so they can triage the results themselves. And when I train people for tattooing, which there's only been a handful, I'm not like teaching everyone, right? Past like this stuff where you get to teach yourself. I don't know. You're not gonna see videos of me going like, this is how you roll the sick line, because it's fucking wrong all the time anyways. Pat color with tight circles, shut up, you're wrong. People are doing it for likes. Anyways, I do this, and when I teach people, I'm teaching them to see what's wrong, identify it visually, and then give them tools afterwards on how to fix it, because you're constantly in a state of crisis management and tattooing. That is like the goal of this, is to decrease that stress that you feel every time you see something that's fucked up. Because you can just see it, identify what's going on, understand why it happened, and then modify your behaviors instantly. Rather than waiting for an entire tattoo to be finished, looking at it, breaking it apart, and then trying to fix it after. Which is woefully just not good. It's inefficient as hell, right? So, If you're thinking that color is different than black, or all of these, like red is different than green, et cetera, I'm sorry, but you're wrong. They're all ink. And if you talk to any experienced artist worth their, you know, salt, they'll say the same thing to you. Now, there is more complexity to this, and we can probably put in, you know, an ellipses at the bottom. The last one would always be, lastly, skin tone and texture. So if you're trying to do certain things on different people, you're going to get different results. If you're trying to do a tattoo and expect it to turn out like it does on your tablet or a piece of paper or on a canvas, just remember that the skin is a living, breathing organ. And when we put stuff into it, it is subject to that skin's specific structure and environmental response as to how we're actually going to see the tattoo that's in it. So if you are doing a tattoo and it didn't turn out the way that you want, and you feel like you don't kind of suck, you used, you know, the techniques correctly that you needed to, and you shook up your ink and it's still turning out poorly, only then may it be that the skin texture and tone may have something to do with it. Like I work with a guy who has technically like fragile skin syndrome, right? It's scleroderma, and doing tattoos on that is exceptionally complex. And the tattoos, how they heal out, are never going to be like some, I don't know, California beach bum at 19, fucking Vogue, whatever bullshit, right? It's not going to be the same. And so having that expectation that I'm going to do it like this on this person is not, it's not apt, it's not intelligent. You have to be experienced enough to understand what the outcome is going to be to design a tattoo that's going to work for that person. You can't just take any design and fit it to anyone. So that kind of does go back to you kind of suck, because then you're making tattoos that you shouldn't be doing on someone because you don't know enough about what you're doing. But I guess that's why you're here, to learn a little bit more. So if you're wondering about that one, there's tons of videos. I think we've done a lot. In the like 18 months I've been making videos. So that's it. That's it for today. I know a lot of people ask for this. This is probably not the answer that you were wanting. Sorry, but this is what it is. I did tell you how to fix it though. And if you can't fix it, just kind of blame yourself. And blaming yourself, the negative reinforcement can be a benefit at times. I mean, it's overdone, just like anything, everything in moderation. If you're doing this and you do it, it can give you the drive to continue on, or it can force you to stop. And either way, that's a benefit to all of the clients out there. Because one, you're going to stop messing people up, or two, you're going to get better. That's it for today. Like, subscribe, do all that shit. Become a member of the show. You can subscribe to YouTube. It's $1 a month. We don't give you anything, but oh, that'd be nice. We appreciate you. We have a few so far, which is fucking wild. So thank you, all of you. We're thinking about making member-only content. So for $1 a month, you can see some stuff. Like today, we're going to be doing a single fine line thin arm band wrap. And we have a technique about how to apply it and how to actually like figure it out scientifically if it's going to work with an individual or not. I might put that up on there. I don't know. Maybe. Maybe not. Maybe everyone should just get it. No, I think we'll make it member anyways. That is, hold it over your head. You can learn more if you pay me money. Whoa. Capitalism. Anyways, that's it. I hope you all have a good day. Bye for now.